So, can you hear me? Yes. Okay, the sound?
Yeah.
So let's start, first of all, I think it's important, the motivation. First of all, why we're here, and what we're doing, and how we're going to spend the time here. When you wake up in the morning, the first thing you do, motivation, you check your motivation. When you go to sleep, you check what you did, and you check the motivation. Why? Because the motivation is a very important factor, especially also with the karma. It's very connected, the motivation. The action can be the same, but if your motivation is different, then the karma is different. So you can do a action with a positive motivation, and maybe the action is not so good, but if the motivation is positive, then the karma can be positive. The negative karma is minimum. But the other way around, the negative karma can be very big because of the motivation. If your motivation is selfish, then of course it's going to be different than if it's selfless, if you want to help somebody, you know. So we are all human beings, right? We are the same. Our body works the same way. You know, we all have blood, we all have bones, we all sweat, we all sleep, we all eat, we all suffer and we have fun. We also enjoy. So that's why it's very easy for us to have empathy for other people. It's something we are born with. We are already born with empathy, we are already born with all the good qualities. We have that inside. The thing is that we have to discover. It's like a diamond, but it's still like carbon, you know, like charcoal. So we have to create the causes for the diamond to shine. But we all have the diamond. So that is basically, originally the religions and the philosophies all started from trying to understand what life is about, the purpose of life, why we are here, what are we doing, where are we going, where did we come from. To answer all these questions, originally spirituality or religion or philosophy originally started because of that. So from the beginning of humanity, we don't know how long that is, but from the very beginning, we have always searched for a God or the truth. You know? So we have, right now, today, we have available all the information of all the practice and the experience of so many people, you know, from many, many thousands of years ago. So this is called tradition. And of course, through spirituality and religion, it has been discovered that when we want to help, when we want to give the best of ourselves to other people, then we receive more happiness, more joy, it's more fulfilling. And when we want to act, our actions, our thoughts, our speech is based on selfishness. The motivation, the purpose is selfish. To make ourselves happy, or to make us feel better, or to fill us up, then the result always is suffering. In the short run, in the long run, depends. Maybe we can't see it immediately, but that will be the result. And this has been already tested and demonstrated. So even like the reason why is also because of the education, you know, how we were raised. And also because of the mentality of the society. Even from the beginning of humanity already, like a father would say to his son, okay, take the sword or take the spear and go show the other father who the real boss is. You know? This mentality started from a long time ago. Like, we have the big ego maybe, and then we have a discussion, argument. And then how do I show who's the strongest? By force. So this kind of action has existed from a long time ago. where the father sends his son to show who's a strong one, show them who the real boss is, or who the blah blah blah. You know, it's just ego. This concept has existed for a long time ago. And in the name of the ego, many wars have been created. I think basically I could say all the wars have always been based on the ego. All the wars of humanity, probably. Most, I think all, probably. Because somebody wants something, or the other one wants to show the other person they're stronger, etc., etc. But based on the ego. So, for example, even from the very moment we start speaking our first words, what do we learn? The first thing. Which is the first word you learn when you're a baby? Mama. La mia mama. No? Sì. And so that's why when the first words, already we are separating. Already we are creating this concept of ego. My mama, my papa. Already.
Però nel momento stesso in cui diciamo mia mamma, ecco che si comincia a creare la separazione. La mia mamma e il mio papà, qua si crea la separazione.
So that's why already we are raised with that kind of concept, you know? But if you search for the ego, it doesn't exist. You can't find it. You can only find the problems that result from the ego. But you can't find the ego. It's just a concept. Because you can also use, the ego also has a good purpose, right? It's to say, I want to improve in order to help other people, improve also. So in that way, we can also use the ego in a positive way. But most of the time, we don't. So that's why it's very, 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 very important to check the ego all the time. To check where the thought is coming from. Because the thoughts come and go all the time. This is something normal. Just like the clouds in the sky. Sometimes they come, sometimes they go. But if you go to touch them, you can't catch. So that's why you have to understand the thoughts are not always real. They're not always true. And many times we think it's true. We even identify with our thoughts. Yeah, so that's a big mistake. To give so much importance to the thoughts. Sometimes maybe something happens which creates an attitude in us and a state of mind, and then the thoughts come from that state of mind, from that emotional aspect of ourselves, and we just let loose. We give the command to the thoughts, we give the command to the emotions. And then what happens? And then every time we go into this like boucle, you know, like this pattern. You know, we are thinking, we give so much importance, and then, like, we even think it's the biggest, like, the whole world is going around that, almost. You know, like, it's the end of our life, it's the end of everything. Many times people who commit suicide is because they're like that. They're in that, you know, going around, round, 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 in the thoughts. They don't have the capacity to go out of the bubble and look from outside. If they did, then they would never commit suicide. They would know that, you know, maybe next day or tomorrow, things can change. So many possibilities. And for humans, we have a huge opportunity. It's like a bird flying in the sky. You can go any direction you want. You can go up, down, left, right, anywhere you want, yeah? Wherever you see so far, you can go there also. That's how it is to be human. You know, we have so many choices. Every moment, we can choose to be who we want to be. So, we have a choice, right? We always have a choice. We can choose who we want to be. Anytime. No need to blame others for our problems. We are the responsible ones. Because it's based on how we react to the circumstances. How we choose to react. Like in hot water, you can choose to be a potato. Or you can choose to be an egg, right? The potato becomes soft, the egg becomes hard. But the circumstances are the same. Right? Right or left? Yeah, it's very easy to blame others for our problems. Very easy. What's difficult is to take responsibility on how we react. That's the difficult part. That's the challenge. I think most of the problems on this planet is based on, one of them I think is for sure, blaming others. Wanting more, unsatisfaction, and also projecting out negativity, valuing negativity more than positivity. I think that's also one of the main reasons why we have so many problems on this planet. I like to make the same example because it's really, for me it impacts me a lot, this example. I'm sure some of you have already heard. But for example, a mother who raises 5-6 children by herself and sends them to university, gets them a job, everything, for 20-30 years, that woman, she will never make headlines in the newspaper, right? When you see single mother raise 7 children by herself for 30 years in the newspaper, difficult, right? Probably not. But mother killed her son, headline. Why? Why is that? Think about it. One mother for 30 years she worked so hard, the other mother in 1 second she did something and suddenly she's super famous, everybody's talking about her and nobody's talking about the mother who raised children for 30 years. Why is that? Think about it. It's because we value negativity more than positiveness. Something bad happens, we give much more, much importance. Oh, blah, 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 this happened. Oh. Positive things happen. Oh, boop. Okay, no, it's not so important. Why? It's the way we think. It's the way we are raised. So that's, we have to always be aware of these patterns of the mind, which is really not very healthy. So like, for example, criticism. As humans, we love to criticize. We love it. Why? Why do we love it? Why is it so interesting to criticize and to listen to criticism? Because it makes us not so aware of ourselves. We don't want to investigate us. We don't want to check ourselves. We don't want to accept criticism on ourselves. We don't want to recognize our mistakes. Why? Because it's much more easy to point at other people. They did this, that, he, blah, 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 that, blah. But you don't check yourself. Why? Because it's more easy. So much more easy. Just to worry about, oh, who else does the right thing and wrong thing. But what does that help? It only creates problems for you. Because really, it's not none of your business, actually. We have no right to judge anybody. I mean, how can we judge somebody that we don't know? How can you know what those people have been through? How do you know? You have to wear their shoes. I mean, not literally. But you have to walk in their shoes, and you don't know what they've been through since their childhood, or their life, what's happened to them, what they did, how they think. There's so many things, so many different things, aspects in life that we don't know about that person. So we have no right to judge. I mean, we don't even know ourselves very well. We don't know how we are going to react tomorrow if something happens. Certain things happen. Many, many times we react in a way that surprises us. Why? Because we don't know ourselves. So if we don't even know ourselves, how can we even think we have the right to judge others? It's ridiculous. So that's very interesting, because that's when we really, really realize we don't know it ourselves. I don't know how I will react in certain circumstances in the future. I will know if that happens, when that happens. But until then, I don't know. I can expect something, I can project something, but I don't really know. So that's why I think it's very important to understand that if we have to judge, because there's human nature, at least don't condemn. Right? Because everybody changes. Because sometimes we say, oh no, that person is like that. Then we condemn, we close ourselves, we shut up. But that person, they can change also. But either way, it's none of your business. Your business is to focus on yourself and to evolve, to improve, to find your peace inside so that you can help and affect the other people also. That's the main purpose, right? For example, if you're living in a cave somewhere, isolated from humanity. Right? Then you can think, oh, I'm the most humble person in the world. I'm so patient. I never get angry. You can, wow, feel so holy. Right? And then suddenly, if you have to go into the humanity, let's say family or your parents or something like that, then when someone is shouting here, another person is shouting here, and then criticizing God, that's when, you know, the Tibetan they say, "Loom," you know, the wind, the anger, the emotions come up, right? So you need a catalyst for you to see that. Otherwise, you probably think you're the most patient person in the universe, right? Yeah. Lume in Tibetano significa vento. Vento? So I'm not talking about the realized beings that are meditating. I'm talking about the normal people. You know? So that's why, for example, if somebody makes you angry, you have to thank them. Why? Because they're helping you to see that. Which by yourself is very difficult to see. When you're alone, it's very difficult to understand your emotions. Very difficult. How do you get angry by yourself? Difficult, huh? See? Yeah, it's very difficult to get angry if you're alone. Right? Or lose patience. It's difficult, no? Unless maybe you're a little bit crazy. But what is crazy? That's a good question also. Crazy, I think, is point of view also, depending, no? Circumstantial. In Tibetan we say, if there's somebody talking by themselves or laughing by themselves, it means they're crazy. But I don't know if this is true or not. But in Tibetan we say like that. Yeah, so that's why I think it's very important always to thank the people, to be appreciative of the company you have. Whoever it is, however they are, whichever impression they give, however, whatever energy they're giving to you, whether it be good or bad, we always have to be thankful. Because either way, we are able to transform and adapt to the circumstances in a positive way. And for me, that's the first step in Dharma. So if we can do that, then already we made a big step, very big step. So that's because the main purpose of Dharma, or any religion, any spirituality, it's to find what works for us, what can we identify with, and it is to help us to understand ourselves better, to find more inner peace, and to be able to improve and move forward, evolve, you know. And with that inertia, then we also help everybody around us. Even if it doesn't seem like it, it affects people. Our hearts are all vibrating, they're all creating, you know, frequencies. So even if you don't think so, it does affect the other people. The collective memory, you could call it. You know. It's just a concept, you know. But it does help to create motivation. You know. It helps a lot. Because, like, for example, sometimes it is more difficult to, like, love ourselves than to love other people. It's more difficult to appreciate ourselves than to appreciate other people. It's more difficult to give to us than to give to others. It sounds ironic, but it's true. Yeah, to love ourselves than to love other people. It's more difficult to appreciate ourselves more than to other people. If you have to cook for yourself, we just do whatever, it doesn't really matter. We don't prepare nice food and everything. When we cook for other people, four or five people come, then we prepare. We put a lot of love, attention, and we really do something. But if nobody's coming, we don't really do it. At least for me, it's like that. Me, if I'm alone, I don't cook. I just, you know, like just eat anything from the fridge, you know, or microwave something, something easy. I don't take time and dedicate myself to cook if it's just for me. So in this way you can see that naturally we all have the empathy towards others before ourselves. That's a natural case for everybody. And we have a lot of difficulty to appreciate ourselves. It's for example, just like an example, okay? If you take a group photo, yeah, it's a group photo. When you look at the photo, who is the first person you look at? Who? Yourself, no? And what is the first thing you think? You look for the defects. Immediately. This, I think, is probably universal. Why? Why is that? No, you have to check. Research, observe. And then you say, oh, I'm so ugly, I don't look good, blah, 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 blah. And then if you look at the same photo 5 years later, you look at yourself again, you say, wow, hey, I was looking good at that. I wish I was like that again now. Right? So what changed? The photo changed? Your mind changed, right? Yeah. So these small details you have to always observe to understand the process. Our mind versus the ego.
Yeah.
The ego is a big problem. Huh? And the ironic thing is it doesn't even exist. We make an ego like a mountain. Big mountain. And then we can't even see on the other side what is going on. But we can climb the mountain and look far away also. So you can also use it, you know? You can use, it's not about like fighting or the enemy, destroy, annihilate. It's not about that. And you can also think that way if it works for you. But it's about becoming the ally and using it, putting it to work for a good purpose. Then it's, you use the resources you have, like the mind. The mind sometimes is moving all the time, going here, there, blah, 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 blah. It's like a monkey mind, right? Everywhere. But if you put the mind to work, then you're doing something. Like if you concentrate on the breathing in, you're putting the mind to work. So already, you're using something, one of your resources, towards a goal, right? To not to be the slave of your mind, not to be the slave of your emotions, you know, to become, like Filippo said, the captain of your boat, right? If you're not the captain of your boat and the wind comes and it can take you, who knows where it will take you. And if it comes too strong, then it will break the sails, it will break the boat, and you'll probably end up floating with some raft, like Robinson Crusoe. You end up in an island for 20 years. So that's why it's important to be the captain of your boat. It's very important to always, at all times, be aware of how your mind works, how it reacts to the circumstances, and always be ready to be there. You know, say, no, I'm not going to react in this way, I'm going to react this way. Because this is positive, this is helpful, this is constructive. And the more you do that, the stronger the pattern becomes, the stronger the habit becomes. Because we are creatures of habit. Even the habit from past lives sometimes can come to this life without knowing. You know, it can affect. So the habit is something we also have to check, right? So I want to talk also about the comfort zone. So we are all in our comfort. And until something big doesn't happen, many times we don't move. We just chill, relax. And many times we may be suffering, we don't even know we're suffering. Because of the comfort zone. We just become very lazy. I think it's lazy. So we just completely get used to our comfort zone. And for example, right now in Syria, for example, many people there, completely out of their comfort zone. They're running, they have no food to eat right now. They're trying to find a place to sleep, you know, trying to protect their children, trying to protect themselves. They're very cold, hungry, scared. You know, all these situations are happening right now. And people are killing each other all the time. Every time somebody shoots a bullet, someone's making money and someone else is dying. You know, this is the situation in the world today. The top three business in the world is, number one is war, the most profitable business. Number two would be, I think maybe pharmaceuticals, pharmaceutical industry. Number three is drugs and prostitution. So all three are a little bit, I mean, pharmaceuticals is good because it's helping a lot of people, but the motivation is to make money. You know, and not always is it very good for the body. Sometimes it has counter effects. You have to know how to use the pharmaceutical medicine in the correct way. Sometimes it can be very necessary, but sometimes it can be more harmful than helpful. So we also have to be able to value that and balance. But what I'm trying to say is that the number one and number three top businesses or profits in the world is about hurting other people, destroying, and like that. So why is this? You know, we allow this to happen, obviously, since the beginning of time. War has always been very profitable. So I just want to point that out now, because I think it's important to be aware of our comfort zone, you know, how well we are. You know, we have everything. Bed to sleep in, we have warmth, we have company, we have food, water, we're not scared for our life, we're not scared for the life of our children or our parents or our family, you know. So we have very good comfort zone right now. We have the basic, but beyond the basic, that would be a little bit unsatisfactory.